Well, I think this was...
Graham Allen from Edinburgh, supplier to surgeons. Today he's got something else on his mind.
It's certainly something that's going to challenge me, mentally and physically, in ways that I haven't been challenged before.
Denise Peat from Surrey, working with the EEC in Brussels.
I think it's going to be a thought-provoking week, a fun, interesting, and probably most of all, it's going to be educational.
The ratio, I suppose, being that the...
David Cavender in London, ex-marine, now reading law.
It's going to be very interesting, meeting people from a variety of countries and talking about their problems.
Simon Bell from Stoke-on-Trent, managing director of a pottery making bone china.
It's very grueling training, especially as I'm the oldest member in the team.
Emma Frau from Durham, overseas business trip organiser.
It's going to be very challenging because I think we're going to have to look at things from an international perspective.
Gerard Leahy, London, geography student.
For me, it's going to be a long way from the normal student life I'm used to.
And Jim Mackay from Fife, looking for a job after university.
Because it's such a new event, I'm a bit apprehensive.
Well, what is it, this forthcoming event they all talk about? Sport? War? War without weapons, perhaps. But these aren't your armed forces, not your regulars, anyway. They're the reservists, the part-timers.
What do you actually get when a reserve officer takes off his uniform? You get a lawyer, a doctor, a clerk, or a technician. And what do you get when a regular officer takes off his uniform? Dirty washing.
The Reserve Officers of NATO. Each year they gather for a vast congress. This year it just happens to be held in Britain. And a very clear distinction is made between brain and brawn. There are the top brass here to discuss international defence amid all the protocol and pomp and ceremony that you'd expect. Then there are the young, high-flying officers picked for their brainstorming sessions and lectures. And thirdly, based out at Sandhurst, the macho athletic types. For them, the military competition. 3 days, 4 events, and 43 three-man teams from 11 NATO countries. The shooting, the first event, goes on all day. A continual barrage of shots from three weapons. Pistol, rifle, and submachine gun.
Three, two, one!
One of the form tips are Denmark, but the Danes run into a spot of bother.
I had one round after the time, sir.
And the first gentle ripple of discontent disturbs the NATO alliance.
It is rather weak. It's difficult to hear it.
And the Brits also prejudice the peace. Graham Allen's found guilty of breaking the rules, nearly gets disqualified for dissent, then has to reshoot, and that's a disaster.
We've been training for the last 6 months that when you shoot this weapon, the SE-80, you can rest the magazine which comes out of here on the ground. And because none of the other countries have been doing this, the ruling was made that you couldn't rest the weapon. Unfortunately, we were firing on shingle, and when you dig in, the shingle was brought up and touched the bottom of the magazine. It was then said that I was resting the weapon. It then took 4.5 hours of appeals, counter-appeals, to get rid of that, and unfortunately my shooting wasn't quite so good when I did the reshoot.
And did you lose your calm?
I did, and the whole body was shaking.
Isn't this meant to be a peaceful NATO, bringing together all the fellow members of countries? And...
It's also a competition, and we're here to win.
But Allen's team, UK4, have a saviour, a Southampton student, Rich Beaumont. Beaumont scores 152. Outstanding.
It's almost like a telescoping. All you have is just a sight picture and a target. And it's just a rhythm. And you feel as if you're not concentrating and you're not consciously doing it. You're just ticking over. It's just a rhythm which has come through all the practice whereby these things come naturally.
Well, things are looking up. Thanks to Beaumont's machine gunning, UK4 finish about halfway in the shooting. And Gerard Leahy, the geography student, and his young teammates of UK3, well, they do even better getting into the top 10. Our other four teams, well, they struggle. For the Brits, it's a bit like the Olympics. They're up against Americans and others who've trained together almost like professionals. Tony Martin, their manager on the left, has two ambitions. To get into the top 10 for the first time for 8 years and win the novices' trophy for new competitors for the first time ever. Well, Leahy and his mates have made a good start, but after the shooting, that's the position. The big guns at the top, you might say, but three events still to come. Ceremonially, this NATO jamboree actually got off to rather a shaky start. In fact, it was a bomb scare. Inside the Royal Military Academy's Indian Army room, the sniffer dogs went wild. They went in to investigate. The problem seemed to be coming from the old army uniforms. What was wrong? It was the mothballs. It's day two. In the military competition, the agony of the obstacle course. It's a 500-meter course. There's some 20 obstacles to overcome. You have to be fit. Some say this is the most grueling part of the whole event. We'll see in a moment.
The team now running with 5-6-1.
Kick it! Come on, Rudy! Come on! Push!
Woo! Good job, Bubba.
Good job, Marty.
Oh,
it's all right.
Hey, that's good.
It's the best time so far. Good job. Good job. Good job.
Head and shoulders. I didn't know you had dandruff.
Shh. I don't. Head and shoulders.
I didn't know you had dandruff.
I don't.
Tests prove it. With ordinary medicated shampoo, dandruff can still be there. But with Head and Shoulders used regularly, it's completely clear.
Head and Shoulders? I didn't know you had dandruff.
I don't.
So don't have dandruff. Have great looking hair.
Meet Admiral Jim and his trusty crew. For our holiday afloat, we saw a man about a boat. He said it needs a coat, but it couldn't offshore. But the rubber band bust, we found some rust. We didn't know just where we would drift. We were scared we might capsize, but at least we'd have supplies. A can or two of Big John Smith's. John Smith's Bitter, a beautiful pint with a bit of Yorkshire bite. So Arthur dropped the anchor, which very nearly sank her. We'd have filled up like a tanker if it wasn't for Roy. Then we nearly had a mutiny as supplies came under scrutiny. But mateys, look what I can see, treasure ahoy. So we got ourselves a tow, he knew the way to go to the bounty of a Big John Smith's.
The Queensway sale is now on, with 3 days of lowest ever prices on a limited range of best-selling furniture. Hurry, these special offers must end Monday. The Queensway sale is now on.
You'll soon be making an important decision to buy a new car. Make your choice Renault from Priory. You'll know it's the right one.
So from the far side, Phil Bird, Hugo Barker and Ian Webster. First of our British teams in the NATO military competition obstacle course. Down from the 5-meter ladder, then 19 more obstacles, each testing and torturing a different part of the body. The stepovers. Then for 20 meters, the crawl unders with half a meter of headroom. Next, the stepping stones, deceptively difficult. A 2 meter, 3 bar gate. The beam, come off it and, as with all obstacles, go back and do it all over again.
Go for it! Go for it! Go hard!
Climb up a 4-meter slope. Get up, over and under the bars. And next, one of the most difficult obstacles of all, the 2-meter Irish table. Halfway round now and 10 more wretched things to get under, over or across. These guys running under the label UK 5 are the most experienced of our 6 teams. Hugo Barker on the left, he's an insurance broker, first competed 8 years ago. Possibly the fastest of the 3, but that's purely academic because the essence of this event is that it's the last man's time that counts. And that looks likely to mean Ian Webster, who's a surveyor from Geordieland. Coming up now, another of the most dreaded hazards, a 2-meter bear pit. Come on. 160 meters and 10 obstacles to go, beginning with a masochistic touch in a few paces from the lowest point of the course to the second highest, the 4-meter ladder. Now the zigzags. They look simple, but they're not, because by now your whole equilibrium has been absolutely shattered. Two to go. First the chicane, twisting and turning on the run. And then in quick succession, the final walls. The last man's time counts, remember, and anything around 3 minutes is respectable. And it's all over. Everyone somewhat exhausted, and not least Phil Bird.
Recently qualified doctor. I think we need your expertise.
You're preferred to be in hospital at the moment.
How did you actually do time-wise then?
3:12 apparently, which is about 2 seconds more than we'd hoped for. We're going for 3:10, so a little bit off.
Tell you what,
I didn't fall off anything worse than it is.
It's those novices you've got to watch.
Yes.
The younger man.
That's right.
Hugo, how are you feeling?
It never gets any easier. Yeah. It just never gets any easier.
Yes, Simon!
Well, it certainly can't get any easier for Simon Bell, the pottery boss from Stoke, because he's 33 and that's just 2 years under the age limit for the class.
Yeah, looking good, Tim, looking good.
This is the UK 2 team, just over halfway round. And of course, what makes this event so tough is that all these chaps are just part-timers. They don't normally get the chance to practice over obstacle courses. Simon, despite his years, has been leading his teammates by a long, long way. He's just been caught by Tim Richardson, but as I say, that doesn't matter one bit, because the most important person's the last. He's the chap the pressure's on, in this case, Ian Howard. In this competition, you have to pick teams who'll be competitive at every event. Ian may be the slowest over the obstacles, but he'll be the team's leader when it comes to the orienteering. Well, the best time so far, as we heard, has come from one of the American teams, 2 minutes 56 seconds. Ian's not going to get near that, but every second saved is crucial because the championship's decided on a point system spread over all 4 events.
Come on, 3 minutes, 22.9. How did it go?
Good, thanks. A bit tough.
You said absolutely knackered. Are you actually the oldest
member? I am the oldest member.
Did you feel it going over that course?
Well, I came in first, Anneka.
Well done. It's incredible, though, with your job as, I must say, Managing Director of Fine Bone China Company. I mean, it's a far cry from obstacle courses, isn't it?
It is, that's why I do it. Take the pressure off the job, come here. I don't know which is harder, actually, this or the job.
UK 4, the team who had that bittersweet day in the shooting. Graham Allen, Rich Beaumont, and bringing up the rear, Chris Maund. And this could be the fastest British time so far. UK 4 going slightly better at the moment than Hugo Barker's team. And setting the pace, it's Allen, the hospital salesman, desperate to make up for his shooting catastrophe. Oops, that could be critical. 2.5 seconds lost.
That's right! Go quicker! Go! Come on, quicker! Come on, quicker! Come on, quicker! Come on! Go on! Come on, really hard! Go on! Come 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 on!
The time, 3 minutes 12.5.
There you go.
Rich exhausted, but Graham once more the full guy.
Did you hurt yourself?
No. Trying to keep up these youngsters, that's the problem. It's too old.
Could it be true that your mind was perhaps on other things?
Well, just other things, possibly.
What's happening?
I'll waste your baby any day now.
Really?
So I've had that pressure at night thinking, is she going to come or not? Luckily, the baby must know the competition's on because it's staying here.
It's staying out of the way until it's finished.
And it's not coming till Friday.
You know, it's a funny thing. Exhausted they may well be, but it's remarkable the first thing they all think about.
Where's that girl I want to kiss?
Oh, I was going to come and ask you a few interesting questions. Just speaking of it. In 1978, you actually had a female member of your team. Was that a success?
Yes, it was. It was Gabrielle Savard. She did very well. The team placed in the middle of the competition. The only place that she had real problems was on the obstacle courses. Her height and her body size were a factor in there. She was a good shot, and she was actually the orienteer on the Canadian team.
It does seem strange to me, we're now 10 years on, 1988, you'd think that more women competitors would come forward.
Females that have had tried it out have found that it is just very difficult because of the difficulty of the obstacle courses mainly.
Now, David Juxon, Jerry Osborne, and on the far side, Gerard Leahy. Britain's novices out to win the overall championship for first-timers. Certainly the youngest team, Leahy, the geography student, 19, Osborne, 22, and their teammate Juxon, also 19.
That's it, we're on time. That's good, we're on time.
Lying third in the novices' championship after the shooting, behind American and Danish teams, and a good performance in the obstacle course, utterly essential.
What's the sound? Get the sound off your feet. Balance. Steady. Good. Steady. Good. 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 Go on now, let's go. Come on,
boys.
Go on, Jerry.
Go on, Jared.
Keep going, man. Go on, come on. Go on, Jared. 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 Go on, Jared.
They'll probably need a time inside 3:08 to give them a chance. And at halfway, Leahy, the back marker at the moment, had done 1:32, just inside the required schedule. Well, that's certainly the best British time so far. In fact, 3:06.3.
Worse than you thought, better than you thought.
Better, I think.
What was it fun?
Any of you want a career full-time in
I'm the going course? In September.
Yes, all of us.
Where are you off to?
I'm into Sandhurst in September.
Fantastic.
I'm going Army Air Corps in 1990.
Yeah.
And I'm going,
we're both going to Sandhurst at the same time.
Terrific.
We've been at school together for 15 years.
This is so emotional. It's like this is your life.
I love it.
But now, from three young first-timers to a man who's something of a legend, this is his 15th annual appearance.
Can I be very rude and ask you how old you are?
I'm 42.
And 2 years ago, didn't you win or something?
Yes, 2 years ago my team won the competition overall open division in Athens, Greece.
When you actually take part in a competition like this, are you thinking purely of the athletic side of it, or is there a more serious motive?
No, we prefer not to call it a sport or athletics. We prefer to call it military leadership training in a combat environment. And that's what we're after, is we're after that stress on our leadership ability and marksmanship, land navigation, and obstacles, because these are the obstacles that will be faced with in wartime situation.
And in their closing stages, here are the French and what looks like a very fast time indeed. The best so far, remember, is around 2:56. Two minutes 48. In fact, officially 2:47.9, and that's the best we've had. And now the top brass. A distinguished coach party, Brain paying homage to Braun, taking time off from Congress at Chelsea. To the competitors, these men are the grown-ups, and in turn they call the athletes, condescendingly but affectionately, children.
Oh, terrific! great. Well, we're proud. All of you are proud of you. You had great fun with the other competitors too, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
They're a super group of guys, aren't they?
Good that we can get together.
Amen. That's the way it should be. We're allies, and we got to even be stronger.
Sorry,
and the
sir,
fact that you're together will keep it that way.
Sorry,
congratulations.
Sir.
Only one team can now beat the French, and they're the Norwegians. Bernt Salgan, Bjorn Engelstad, and Geir Bianis, the three men who astonishingly, give or take one substitution, have won this overall championship 4 times in 5 years. 2:47.9 to beat, and going extremely well. Oh, have those zigzags again been crucial? Salgan and Bianis safely over, but that's no good. They may just as well wait for Engelstad. Can they still do it? Must be inside 2:48. It's going to be close.
Steady, steady, steady.
And no, those lost 2.5 seconds decided it. 2:49.9.
It hadn't been for the lost balance, it would have been better.
Yeah. So what was the problem with that course then?
Well, it's getting... I was running a little bit too fast in the beginning, I think. I don't know.
Oh, you don't seem too happy, but as you say, you've got the swimming to come, and let's face it, you've done so well over all the other years. Maybe it's time to let someone else take the lead.
No.
No?
Well, here's the team who lead at the moment. The Americans, USA 4, winners of the shooting. This isn't the fastest time on the obstacle course, but it's pretty good, and anything under 2:57 is going to be enough to keep them in front. And they've done it! At London's Guildhall, things are more genteel. The Lord Mayor's reception to Congress delegates. Just now, the conversational menu was NATO defence policy. Now, to follow, a heady concoction of tradition, fine fare and name-dropping.
That's all, poor gentleman.
The young gentlemen of the military competition regret that, had they been invited, they'd have felt unable to attend due to another engagement. From the obstacle course to the obstacle swim, the interval 1 hour. Over and under the booms, then under the raft on the first length of a 30-meter pool, and then they'll drag themselves up onto a high platform, turn and head for home. Just one more obstacle on the return length. That's how they stand after two events, two more to come. UK 4, Alan, Beaumont and Maund on the homeward stretch, and again the last man's time counts.
How do you think you did?
Do you want to guess?
Less than 45.
Yes? 42.9.
Yes!
Well done!
That's what we wanted.
Well done.
That's the hardest 42 seconds of my life.
UK's novices, Osborne, Juxon and Leahy. Jerry Juxon, the fastest man, giving the others nearly 4 seconds start, the idea being to catch up and, if necessary, help the slowest swimmer. This trio, UK 3 as they're called, just outside the top 10 teams overall and lying second in the novices event. And looking for a time here, I imagine, of somewhere below 40 seconds.
How do you think it went?
Well, smooth. I'm fast.
I just had the score whispered in my left ear, 41.
41?
Good. Yeah. Best British score so far.
I thought it'd be faster than that. That's all right.
Is that okay? Not too bad.
We're still in there.
Well done.
Thank you.
And the leaders overall, USA 4, Nylon, Harding and Thompson.
On your mark.
These guys are conscious of two things. One, the Italians and Norwegians are close behind them. And two, swimming's their own weakest sport. The Italians have already finished in 38.6. To keep in front of them, the Americans are certainly going to need inside 42. And I think they've done it. Yes, 41.7. Well, the hot tips during training were the Americans and Canadians. But the Canadians seem to have run into a problem.
This is the guy.
He's the jury.
He's stopping the swimmer.
He's stopping the swimmer.
Excuse me.
No, this is
not
popular.
Do you realize you've just caused a major international incident over there?
Well, yeah, but if we didn't do this, they'd have nothing to talk about.
Oh, I see. You've done it before. What is actually the problem?
The thing is, because I put my I put the buttons in the back instead of in the front.
Is that just to be ultra trendy, or was there a secret motive? Just,
there's a reason for it.
I see, a bit of gamesmanship. Less water resistance, I suppose?
They never told us about this, that we couldn't do it even on the official practice. They never mentioned it, so.
What's going on? What's the decision? Oh,
the problem is the uniform is inside out.
Yeah.
And the technical jury, who did not see any other team swimming that way, decided that the Canadian must go and change.
Even though he was dressed like that in rehearsal?
In rehearsal, and other teams have gone through earlier dressed like that. It doesn't really matter. They'll swim well anyway.
Why have you got steam coming out of your ears?
Oh, because they
doesn't matter.
Bug me a little bit, that's all.
Good luck.
Thank you.
But Canada's problems aren't yet over. To go back, one of the Canadians has received the red flag for getting leverage from the upright. The return length swam all over again, utter disaster for Canada, and their coach not the happiest man in Sandhurst. On their marks, United States won. Now this is one of the American novices' teams, reckoned to be very fast indeed, and if they were to do a good time, that would do our lads no good whatsoever. And that is easily the fastest of the day.
Gentlemen, 35.9.
So, in the final swim, two questions for the Norwegian champions. Can they beat that time of 35.9 to win the swimming? And can they take the lead in the competition with just the orienteering to come? This could be very close.
A second behind.
Anyway, we'll be leading.
And indeed they are, because while the swimming finished up like that, the Norwegians have done enough to lead the championship for the first time by a whisker. And no British team yet in the top 10.
We must have the support of not only the men we lead, but also from our personal family members and our friends in the civilian community. The family, above all, must not be ignored.
The need for discipline in society is clear, especially when one views it against the backdrop of the growing epidemic of football hooliganism.
Those at the Young Reserve Officers' Symposium are rehearsing the addresses they'll give at the closing ceremony. Lectured to, formed into international groups, the bright young things hand-picked for the opportunity have been debating serious matters like leadership, NATO cooperation, and their own place in today's society.
Do you regard your job with the forces as it stands at the moment as a hobby, or are you very much aware of the more serious implications of it?
I think it's both. I think it's a hobby, and I enjoy it, and I love what I'm doing. But at the same time, you're aware of what you've gone through the commissioning, and so you have taken that step to commit yourself should you be involved should a war happen. You're there.
We go out and we do the same training as the men. We sit in trenches in the rain, just like anybody else. We fire all the same weapons, and we use all the same equipment and have exactly the same base training.
How do you look at world events? With pessimism or with optimism, perhaps?
I think very much optimism, actually. I think the Gorbachev initiative has to be encouraged whilst we look at it in a sober light and see what actually he does, rather than what he says he's going to do.
Unfortunately, you have to have the war, but afterwards, things flourish, and for about 700 years afterwards, you have very good economic and social sort of standards, and I think it's about time we had something like that.
So you see the inevitability of war as just part of the rich tapestry of life, do you?
Yes. Yep.
This, mercifully, is not war. It's almost a game, a competition for the athletes separately scored. First aid. The Brits usually win.
Yes, forces 18 regular.
This year, prevented from fiddling in their physio, they're fourth.
Helps on its way.
The social scene continues throughout the week. For the Chelsea set, a Scottish evening. For the competitors and young officers at Sandhurst, a barbecue. But it's always just the night before the day after.
Go!
It's a typical British summer's day. Drizzly, slightly chilly, in fact, plain cold, wet and miserable. It's day three of the competition. Today is the orienteering event. The British have got a bit of catching up to do, but this is their favourite event, so they say. And apparently they're going to love every soggy step of the 15-kilometre run.
Iceberg is an alcohol-free German wine. Light, fresh and slightly sparkling. For anyone who needs to travel safely this Christmas.
As you grow up, so does your skin. When can you start using oil of Ulay?
You don't drive a big fast car. You don't look like a movie star. And your money we want.
Oil of Ulay works like the skin's own fluids, so it absorbs quickly to replace lost moisture and help keep your natural beauty. And when can you start? It's a lot younger than you think. Beauty for young skin starts young. With Oil of Ulay.
By dummies, driven by the intelligent.
Ahoy there! Now the Condor's no crisis. Condor mild. Same old Condor, such a mild have been sort of thing. Oh well, welcome aboard, old boy. Yes, I vividly really remember my first flight full of Condor. We were just rounding the Cape. Bit of a typhoon going up.
Nothing should disturb that Condor moment.
Do you feel all right? Oh, 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 oh.
Barbican, alcohol free.
What do you think?
Who are they trying to fool?
We're there. Time is back.
In truth, the orienteering, or military navigation as they call it here, is no picnic whatsoever. Today's course is a grueling maze of a dozen checkpoints concealed within the countryside near Camberley in Surrey. Dense woods and all sorts of terrain. Forest tracks, woodland undergrowth, meadow, bog and lake.
805579.
On the edge of a wood. We're there.
Normal orienteering means finding your way about by compass and map as quickly as possible. But this is a bit different, like carrying cumbersome weapons and wearing heavy boots, and even when the route is marked, hauling yourself down, up and over obstacles.
Keep in between the tape! Keep in between the tape!
For Britain, the early news couldn't be worse. The first team have taken 40 minutes against an average of 26 minutes to get from the start to checkpoint 2, and so it's exit UK1, really. But for none of these spare time soldiers is it easy. Right, well, I've now dashed on ahead to checkpoint 5. I say dashed on ahead, it was by car, I'm afraid to say. And one way or another, a girl's beginning to hear a few unexpected things.
How's it going?
What's going on?
Apparently one of the teams has wandered onto the M3 and was stopped by the civil police.
Which team, do we know?
Well, I believe it was the Greeks.
In Chelsea, a certain apprehension no doubt runs through the Congress about NATO's eastern defences. And if you were a policeman, wouldn't you also question what armed guys in war paint were doing on your patch, even if they did sound like allies?
Yeah, he stopped us, he was grabbing the weapons, going, where'd you get this weapon, where'd you get this weapon, what are you doing out here?
Meanwhile, for Britain, things look distinctly better. UK 2, Simon Bell hanging on grimly, doing extremely well. The same goes for UK 3, third in the novices after the swimming, but still in with a chance. And UK 5, Hugo Barker's team, went extremely fast over the first half, shaping like possible winners.
Keep on running. Keep on hiding. One fine day I'm gonna be the one to make you understand. Oh yeah, I'm gonna be your man. Keep on running. Running from my arms. One fine day I'm gonna be the one to make you understand. Oh yeah, I'm gonna be your man.
The longest, toughest stage comes near the end, from checkpoint 10 to checkpoint 11. To reach number 11, in the corner of a field by a public road, each team have to sketch a map of their route. The temptation, the bait, is to pick up the line of pylons that lead directly to the corner. The bad news is the ground you then run into. It's wild, boggy, muscle-dragging, and generally horrible. Some opt to go by track and road. It's a safer route, but a longer one. But however they go, on arrival, they're tired out.
What's been your worst problem?
Tiredness.
Just knackered.
Yeah. Checkpoint 12 is a sandy bank by a lake.
Just a short run to here. Checkpoint 12 on one side, the finish on the other.
Visible, use an assault boat, wear your life jacket.
Just head over there, please.
Cheers. Come on, Simon.
These UK 2 lads have overtaken five teams. They've reached here in 2 hours, 16 minutes.
Get in, Simon. Get in. Start pushing.
Seven teams have finished, but none as fast as this.
Come on, Tim.
Just 100 metres to go.
And meantime, further back on the course, Leahy, Osborne and Juxon taking the road route to 11, still going well.
Pleasant weather we're having.
And the rain threatens as UK2 approach the end. Once they disembark, it's a 50-metre dash up the shingle to the finish. And they're given an official time of 2 hours 19 minutes. Compute that with their scores for grenade throwing and other skills at the start, and that gives them over 2,000 points.
Great.
So what are you all going to do now then?
I've just got to hang around for another hour or so, and then we'll know whether the time is going to stay as the fastest one of the day.
Well, it was a fantastic achievement and a very special day for you. But Simon, because you had a special reason for wanting it to go well.
Yes, I did. Actually, my father died yesterday.
Well, you showed incredible courage going through with today.
Thanks.
And now Leahy and company, neck and neck with the American team of the veteran Dennis Mansky. The Brits certainly the faster. Mansky's guys started 20 minutes before they did. Just the formality of a race up the beach. Juxon there first. Just a question of the official time and whether that's going to be fast enough to win them that overall novices championship. Well, it's a pretty good one. 2 hours, 25 minutes.
UK 3. You've done it, haven't you?
Well, we didn't know. Well done. We watched the American team. When we got to checkpoint about 11,
yeah,
we heard that they were only about 2 minutes behind us. We had to beat them by 7 minutes, so we thought, you know, that they were chasing us. And we just had to keep going.
How did you find the game?
Some of the bearing distance is the worst because the ground between them was impossible. Kept on going into ditches and things. Jerry kept on falling into sort of bogs.
It's real British summer weather, wasn't it?
Yeah, which is what we're hoping, because the other guys won't find that so easy.
The Brits coming home thick and fast now. Graham Allen and UK 4. A few aches and pains, and 2 hours, 53 minutes. Not a winning time, but good enough.
Please. I wanted to ask you, Graham, any news?
No news yet.
No baby.
I haven't been around for 3 hours, but there's no, as far as I'm aware, there's
Get
no
to
news
that
yet.
Phone box right now. Well done.
United States 4, second in the competition overnight, have been groping and stumbling their weary way towards checkpoint 11. They've gambled and followed the pylon wires. They know they need a fast time to win the overall competition. They know the Italians and Norwegians are threatening them. When they reach the checkpoint and read the instructions, they get a shock. Map? What map?
We do not have the 125,000 map.
Okay, we're doing, I'll get you doing.
Okay, please take me off the clock.
Yeah. What's the time now, please?
2:24:07.
Their timing suspended. But without the map, they say they left at checkpoint 3. They may not find the final checkpoint.
Have him contact the U.S. Chief of Delegation.
At the start, they were given this instruction. Nonetheless, their plea of a misunderstanding is accepted. The Americans are given access to a map.
We were told we could leave our map, which we did. Now they're telling us on another station that we can't run with that.
The Americans, reprieved, proceed to the lake. At checkpoint 11, they're succeeded by Barker's UK-5.
Get any drink of water, please.
Fast early on, and apparently a setback between points 8 and 9. But still possible winners as they go off on the short run to the 12th. And at the finish, everything coming to a boil. UK2's time already beaten, I'm afraid. The Americans making good progress over the water. Leahy and his mates waiting anxiously, their chances of that novices' championship still holding for them at the moment. The Americans, well, very, very tired indeed, and a Danish team arriving at precisely the same time. The American time, unofficially looking very good, around 2 hours 16 minutes, and Barker's boys virtually on their heels. UK 5, 2 hours 30 minutes.
How are you feeling?
I think we're very disappointed. I think when you look at the split times, you'll see that we were probably leading in the first half, and then we made a major error of about 25 minutes, which has probably cost us the competition. So we're very upset.
Good morning.
The Norwegians, the leaders, are on their way to 12. Just the short run down to the checkpoint, and they may be within 150 metres of another win. Unaccountably, they too have made an error of navigation. Years ago in Athens, these three lost the championship because they missed a checkpoint in the orienteering. Could all this, I wonder, be as crucial? At last, they reach the checkpoint. They've taken 11 minutes. Some have done it in 7. Just ahead of them, though not really in contention, the final British team, UK 6. All timings have to be computed with scores for grenade throwing, map reading, and range estimation done earlier. But obviously, the faster the time, the better the chance. Norway need 2 hours 15 minutes to take the orienteering, or 2:19 would still win them the whole thing. And after all that, they fail to do either. 2 hours 28 minutes. The military competition is over, and the results look like this. Britain getting 2 teams in the first 6 in the orienteering, the Americans winning not only that, but the entire competition. Britain's ambition achieved, a team in the top 10. And for UK 3, that's not all.
The winners of the novices category, United Kingdom, third team, officer cadets, Juxon, Leahy and Osborne.
The youngest and best of the British teams. They were third after the swimming, but did it all in the orienteering.
Winners, Captain Thompson, Major Nealon, and Lieutenant Commander Harding.
The presentations, like several of the happenings this week, have something of the Boy Scouts come school speech day atmosphere. And tomorrow, they'll all go home. Again, a bit like boys returning from camp. To wives, families, friends, and jobs. But it's here, at the QE2 Conference Centre in London, the final formal gathering, that the more serious aspects of the week are really brought home to everyone. The Admiral of the Fleet, Sir John Fieldhouse, he's already spoken and warned against the honeyed words of Mr. Gorbachev, pointing out that whilst there hasn't been a burglar in the place for a long time, that wasn't to say there wouldn't be in the future. In fact, already the obstacle course, the swimming, the orientation, the fun events of the week have really been put into perspective.
And please remember the vital contribution which you make to ensuring that the defence forces have the kind of support from our civil populations without which they'll be gravely weakened in the years ahead.
B, the science fiction thriller starts on Monday night on Tyne Tees at 11:25.
Didn't hear you come in. Something's wrong.
Philby.
Let me go, let me go!
Stop it!
Let me go!
It was an accident!
You're lying!
He had a heart attack.
Well, which was it, accident or accident?
It was both.
The hero of the hour. We move into the first minute of injury time. The whistle goes, and Oxford indeed have triumphed against the odds.
So Mark Egan, the victorious captain, and this year, of course, by tradition, he runs the line for Oxford. The big moment, very, very close. The conditions absolutely perfect. It's very cold, but ideal for running rugby. And of course, we have a fascinating contrast of styles with the speed and guile of the Cambridge backs against the might of the Oxford pack. So everything set, the moment coming very close, so the biggest moment for many of these players taking part this afternoon. So let's now go over to our match commentators, Hugo McNeil and Nigel Starmer-Smith.
Welcome all as the soft rays of winter sun pervade this remarkable sporting theatre. Bitter cold, I can tell you, but that's mellowed just a little by the sun, a slight breeze, and the 60,000 capacity crowd taking their seats. And amongst them, well, that's a little prep school called Molesford Prep School, amongst the many youngsters who come to enjoy this remarkable, unique occasion with two teams of students on the traditional second Tuesday afternoon in December. And alongside me, someone who's been to this ground many a time indeed with Oxford and with Ireland, Hugo McNeil. And as ever, you can say the form guide points to Cambridge, but there's no telling, is there, on the day?
Absolutely not. Cambridge once again will come into this match as favourites, as they did last year, but as we've just seen, Mark Egan and his team turned it around. They look to have a more balanced side this year. They've a strong forwards, Cambridge, but real pace in the backs.